Hello and welcome to the Worst Movie Ever Made, an experimental movie podcast designed with one thing in mind, to find the worst movie ever made. I'm your host, Chris Ackman, joined by my co-hosts and fellow mad scientists, Rob Scucci and Bob Hasek. Hey guys, how are you and why are we doing this?
So we're packing and scrambling to travel to Florida with two little kids tomorrow. It's about a 13-hour drive. In the heat of all that craziness, I forgot to eat dinner. So there was some angel hair pasta with Alfredo in the fridge. Right. It's not bad. It's not a gross story or anything, but I was like, I got to eat something because I got to pack immediately after we do the show. And, yeah. You know, I did that, like, nuke it for 45 seconds and eat it, like, still cold in the center, like the Olive Garden experience.
Yeah.
So, speaking of cold, disappointing, congealed blobs of shit, we are going to get into End of Watch.
Yeah.
And that's all. And yeah. Bob, how are you?
Oh, certainly a disappointing, not that I expected anything out of a police movie with Jake Gyllenhaal, but disappointing nonetheless.
He was in Jarhead.
He's not as bad as his sister.
Yeah.
But both of their faces are falling off, so.
Yeah, that is true.
Hey, I've got to kick it over to Bad Reviews. I'm afraid I'm going to knock Bob out of here.
All right.
I'm really scared. Bob, if I knock you out, I'm really sorry.
I understand. It's not personal. At least I don't
think. Okay. Let's see what happens. All right. Where are those bad reviews anyway? Okay. Here's one. Despite the violence and procedural detail, this is about as gritty as Dixon of Doc Green. Have you guys ever seen that?
No.
It's old British show that ran from like 55 to 67, apparently.
That explains why.
And it's about a constable who deals with petty crimes.
That sounds awesome, actually.
Yeah, that was Peter Bradshaw of The Guardian.
It sounds very British.
Yeah. Yeah, doesn't it? All right, Tampa Bay Times, Steve Persall says, End of Watch is a repellent movie. First for its shaky cam conceit, rendering much of the action incomprehensible, and finally for seeking to entertain viewers through the thuggish execution of a police officer, which is, it does make you wonder what are they going for, you know, with this movie. And this it kicked out Bob, I'm telling you.
Yeah, you're on something, dude.
For when you listen to this, Bob,
I just love you.
Yeah, I love you. I'm sorry you're buffering. I know you can't hear me now, but you'll hear me soon, and you'll know that I mean it.
Yes.
Oh, poor Bob. You want to throw it to YouTube comments, or you want to keep stalling until he comes back so that
he'll come in and he has to figure it out because he's sharp, and that adds to the entertainment value, I think.
Bob is sharp.
Yeah. Sharp as a fucking tack.
Right.
What made this movie so good was the chemistry between Jake and Michael Pena. Watching this, you would literally think they've been partners for years. Incredible job by all the cast, but especially Jake and Michael. And then, this movie was always somewhat sad to me, but after I became a cop, and especially after going some of the stuff I've gone through on the streets and watching it again, this movie hit me on another emotional level that I can't explain, especially the funeral scene at the end. Holy crap. And like, I want to make a piece about this real quick. Cause I played in a cover band with a bunch of cops from like 2011 to 2017. Yeah. We were called Jerk. It was Jordan, Ed, Rob, Ken. When one guy like couldn't do shit, cause he was like training for like whatever, another cop, they could all shred. Right. And it's weird. Like every police officer and like volunteer firefighter I've ever met, they're all like fantastic musicians, but like they,
how about that?
None of them live lives like this. I know it's LA and it's a different thing, but like, I don't want to go into what might be your piece later, Bob, but like this, the amount of unplausible things back to back that happen in such a short period of time, like that just doesn't happen.
It's going to be one of my main contentions for sure with how implausible this movie actually is. It's just ramped up to make you feel on edge and tense all the time, but it's not the life of a police officer.
Yeah.
I don't care where you're from. You can be from Chicago and you don't deal with this much shit.
No.
Bob, I'm sorry for kicking you out.
Hey, I was actually hopeful for a while because I felt I was part of the conversation and then suddenly I wasn't. So it must be... Your theory is holding water. It must be part of it, but I just can't imagine why.
Anyway. It makes no sense. It makes no plausible sense, but like it's consistent. It's been tracking.
It's happening. Yes, it has. Yeah. We can see it. So yeah. Let's throw it to test number one, the worst of its kind.
Okay.
Is this film the best of the worst or the worst of its kind?
While we're on the subject of Jake Gyllenhaal and his falling off face, the movie Nightcrawler. Okay. Have you guys seen that one? I think it was a Netflix original.
I haven't seen Netflix originals.
Is Nightcrawler the one where he's a TV news video reporter?
Yes, he's a video reporter, but he's kind of sneaky and like gets around the police and stuff like that to take video he shouldn't be taking, but it's not illegal either.
I liked it better than I liked End of Watch.
Yeah, for sure. And apparently Rotten Tomatoes liked it a lot as well. With a 95, it's undeserving.
Okay.
Undeserving of a 95. It was a good watch. It's dark and it leaves you with the vibe that they were going for. You know, it's definitely one of those movies that achieved what it was trying to do. And I give it credit for that, but it's no, you know, Jurassic Park. It's up there with like some of the best movies of all time. It's like, give me a break, you know? So it makes me wonder about more recent movies with the popularity of Rotten Tomatoes taking off, if they take a little pay under the table to jack
up. They totally do.
Yeah, percentages, which I know I've said before on the podcast, but especially when we do some of these like this is a people think this is a good movie, but it's actually not. The zeitgeist around this movie is, I don't know if that's properly applied, but is that the movie is a good one, and we disagree. But you're going to get movies of high averages, especially because it's 2011, I think.
Yeah, 11 or 12.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, I'm starting to doubt Rotten Tomatoes' more recent movie scores, which isn't good for our credibility because we use it every week.
It's okay. We'll survive.
Yeah, we'll be okay.
Benicio del Toro, he stars in Sicario. This is the more recent Sicario because it's a remake. A 92 for that one.
Okay.
Have you guys seen The Fighter with Mark Wahlberg and Christian Bale?
No.
Actually, it's pretty good. It's not a 91, which Rotten Tomatoes gave it, I don't think, but it's a strong 80, 85, somewhere in that area. And then here's what really baffles me is that Denzel Washington with Ethan Hawke in Training Day got a 73. I thought that was a far superior movie to everything I've listed so far.
And it's crazy because everything in my research for this movie would throw back to be like, oh, this is from the director of Training Day.
Right.
So you'd think Training Day would be like the upper echelon, like pedestal that you're on. And this movie would be trying to hold a candle to it.
This is like the Bud Light to the Budweiser that is Training Day. It's just Training Day is a much better movie than this one.
Yeah.
In my opinion. 73 nonetheless. And then The Town with Ben Affleck, not a movie I was a fan of, but everyone who's ever seen it seems to really like it.
Yeah.
So maybe we can do this again for our, you know, I'll throw that in the poll for our next controversial one and then talk about why it's actually really boring and put me to sleep.
This whole genre is not for me. Like this whole genre, like the reason you guys aren't really into like Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul are the reasons I think I'm not into this. Like, I don't need more realism in my life. I want something that's not trying
I can't wait to get into why this movie wasn't realistic at all.
Yeah.
You're right. That's what they were going for.
With the whole found footage and like the Randy Marsh.
This environment of movies, it's really beyond my. I haven't seen most of the ones you mentioned. It's either a time thing because my kids were growing up then, or it's a genre thing.
Well, check out the only one I would suggest is Training Day, and I actually wrote Training Day is miles better than End of Watch. After all of that, I don't know if I threw out The Town got a 92 on Rotten Tomatoes. Okay. So that gives us an average of 88.6, which is a huge average.
Yeah.
End of Watch, do you guys think it did better or worse than 88.6?
I think I saw it, so you go ahead, Bob.
Hopefully worse. I'm going to hope in the 60s.
It did worse, but it got an 85.
I thought 95, so I might have just misremembered it.
Okay. 85. So it is negative. It's less than the average by a few points, 3.6 to be exact. But it's not the worst of its kind because Training Day, the best movie of the lot, in my opinion, is the worst of the bunch at 73%.
Fuck that.
This is totally wrong.
Like, none of those movies have the line "King Kong ain't got nothing on me."
Yeah, exactly. Right. That, like, there's nothing quotable about End of Watch. Yeah. What are you gonna quote? Like the. Well, we have dialogue to get into. Never mind. Yeah. I'm not going to quote this movie because we have.
No, but for all the film pages I follow, Training Day is way more referenced.
It's highly revered. Yeah.
It's Denzel Washington punching as hard as he can.
Yeah.
And he's just knocking everybody in the movie out, except for Ethan Hawke, who like puts up a decent fight. You know, like it is amazing. It's an awesome movie.
It's Denzel. It's Denzel putting out Master of Puppets. He could have retired after that shit, and people still talk about it.
No doubt.
Yeah.
Metallica reference of the show.
Yeah. Had to get one in.
Yeah, we seem to do that, don't we? Yeah. All right, let's go to test number two, the plot pitch.
Hey, God.
Hey.
Man.
Hey, what? You want to hear my movie idea? No.
3, 2, 1. I remembered. Go.
Nice. Well, before I get into it, I want to tell you guys to just savor this, because the last time we're doing this where Chris writes his own little script, I'm going to throw it to somebody else, let's say, to write the plot going forward. Can't wait for that.
I like it.
Look forward to it. Little foreshadowing. But yes, I will go now in 3, 2, 1. Somebody decided it's a good idea to make a shitty little Spike TV show about two prankster frat boy cops into a movie. I get paid to pitch it, so here it goes. Two cops take turns making home movies while acting funny for the camera in their cop car. A group of gangsters decide they like that idea, so they get a camcorder and tape their own antics on the street. Jealousy ramps up as both parties compete to get their best footage possible for a free t-shirt and $100 from America's Funniest Home Videos. The cops get shot. One dies. $7 million. What do you guys think? Bob?
I would say no, because there's too many of those already.
Okay.
I'm going to go with Bob as well. Just because like they had the opportunity to do like that little scratch on the record player before before they drop like the plot. And I would, if we're going for a star, I'll give it a 2-star. Cause I like your, it's hard grading your pitches. Cause like they're funny and they're like well thought out, but the content that they are describing is garbage and dog piss. So
yeah,
there's like, the 2-star is not a knock at you. It's just a knock at the movie. I just had to get that off my chest.
Well, I've never taken offense, but because my ego can't take it. So,
okay.
I just ignore anything negative.
Just to help your ego, I'll go with a 2.5 for that one.
2.25. All right.
Right.
That's almost halfway there. Okay, we've got the score. We're going to head into test number 3, the worst dialogue.
Sounds good.
The worst movie ever made presents the worst dialogue ever made.
Well, so here we go. This is where the movie really is going to take a dive off the cliff. As soon as we start really talking about it, that's when the movie is going to
dive.
Because it's really, really, really terrible. So, number 10, some gangster guy at the... So, you know the Curb Street gang? It's like an M13 gang, basically. Big Evil actually has an M13 tattoo on the side of his head, so maybe he's an actor who was formerly an M13 member or something like that. But the Curbside gang consists of Big Evil, two ladies, and some other guy who's like learning under Big Evil. That's what I took from the movie. And the younger guy, who's the protege, is talking to some attractive woman at a party. After they give her a shot of who knows what out of a solo cup. And he's like, "Hey, baby, you ever fucked on heroin, baby? I could fuck you for hours on that shit." And then he goes on to describe other, you know, more mouth-oriented things that he could do for hours on end on what he calls heroin, which I've said this before. I think it was on the Street Fighter pod that we did, Rob.
Yeah,
where the guys were talking, they were like doing a drug deal, but they called it like, "Hello, we would like to buy $10,000 worth of cocaine, please." And it's like the most like no gangster would ever say just straight up heroin. It'd be like, oh, you ever gotten like fucked on, you know, Fine China or Yukon Gold or whatever the fuck they would call, you know, some shit like that. But this guy is like, hey, baby, you ever fucked on heroin, baby? it just felt so wrong, which is how this script is.
It's a way of patronizing the audience because, like, maybe the people that are the type of person that would watch this movie and enjoy it needs that spelled out for them.
Yeah, I guess so. Because, like, I need to know exactly what drug he's describing. It wouldn't matter to me if he's, you know, if he said fairy dust, it'd be like, I don't know, it's probably meth or something, but what does it matter to me?
It could be an overdub of a female's voice going, drugs. Like, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Number nine is the three mentions and failed attempts at the Liberace AK-47 joke. Yeah. Michael Pena's character, Zavala, they are pulling a bunch of shit out of this pickup truck. And one of the things they pull out is this gold-plated AK-47. And he turns to Brian Taylor, his Jake Gyllenhaal's character, his partner in crime fighting. And he's like, oh my God, it's Liberace's AK-47 or whatever. And it didn't hit then. But I think they thought maybe we didn't get the point across, because then when they're in the police station going back over the evidence, he says to the sergeant, it's Liberace's AK-47. Yeah. And then another like 30 seconds passes and he mentions how it's Liberace's AK-47 again. And I just thought it was crazy because, one, it wasn't funny the first time, the second time, or the third time, but Liberace is a very outdated reference where even in 2011, a lot of people aren't going to know who Liberace is. I do. Yeah. I can see him doing the Rockhead thing on stage. I know that he was one of the first like very out in the open homosexual men to come out and let the world know, which is great, a pioneer. But a lot of people didn't know who he was as recently as
It's a weird reference.
It is, and it wasn't funny, and it was three times.
Yeah. Especially for the audience of this movie, it really is a strange reference, because, like you said, for the age of the actors and the age of the audience, I do feel like it'd be missed.
I feel like if you had said Elton John instead, it would have been funnier.
Yeah.
And just say it once, you know?
Or Freddie Mercury, because he's a more household name, and he always will be. I guess it's defiantly gay. Like someone who's like very, like, you know, like it's proud.
Yeah, Richard Simmons has an AK. Who knew? You know?
Yeah.
And to Chris's point, it doesn't need a callback at all.
No. Definitely not. Okay. Here's a quote from Big Evil. He says, all right, you ready for this, Bob? Definitely did a TikTok about the kind of content I'm about to hit here, but we fucking get the upgrade right now. Not fucking going to be no fucking tykes, no fucking more. Not going to fucking come in here in our fucking hoods and fucking disrespect us. That was just a snippet where fucking was every third word. But we're going to throw it to some clips pretty soon where you get a little bit more of that. Not starting here with number seven. This is our first clip of the day called Officer.
You know, I see you guys out here. You're being good little company men, aren't you? You're doing the Lord's work. And you're making a difference, as you call it. It's all fun and games to you. You get to run and jump and fight and shoot. One day, mark my words, one day the LAPD is going to bend you over your black and white, and they are going to fuck you up the ass. They are going to fuck you so long and so hard, you're going to want to eat your gun just to make it stop. And if you don't eat your gun and the fucking somehow magically stops, they're going to give you freeway therapy. You're going to end up doing West End Valley Day Watch, spending 2 hours every day on the fucking freeway just thinking about the fucking that they gave you. Bad guys attack from up front. Department comes in from the rear. Watch your six.
I'm ready. This may say Purell, but it's really KY. Officer Zavala.
It's so bad. This is only our seventh.
Yeah.
We have six more to go after this.
Oh, no.
Yeah, we do.
I feel bad for Hopper from Stranger Things, because that's who that was.
Yeah.
As I'm sure you know, Van Housen or whatever his name is. Very, like, Rammstein band member kind of name.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's a very cliched, like, you know, he's the hard ass character kind of dialogue. Oh, they're going to bend you over, your black and white. They're going to fuck you. And if you're not, if you don't eat, you're done. I think the script is really poorly written by people who maybe got their first chance at the job, but it's not that surprising with the before mentioned $7 million budget that they had for this movie. They must not have gotten anybody a substance to write the dialogue.
That's the thing I mentioned, because I was a I was a creative writing major, and you know, I work in that realm, and you could tell when something's been revised like 100 times and has not. And this seems like for me, I always hated reading a novel or a short story where the line of dialogue is like the whole page. Because, like, you don't get that in real life without, like, an or being interrupted. Like, in no world will you not be interrupted when you're talking.
Yeah.
First of all. And second of all, it's like, you don't have these, like, soliloquies when you're just freaking broing out. It's it's like someone wrote this in Intro to Lit 101 and then, like, just pass it off to the editor. The editor, like, checked it off and sent it off to production.
Right. Yeah. Whatever. Yeah, like, whatever. It's just, it went straight to the director, and he was like, all I asked you for was a script. I didn't say we had to double check it.
Yeah. Fuck this movie.
Yeah. All right. This is a little Gyllenhaal and Pena, which we focus on because the movie really focused on those two. It didn't give many people many lines. So, Taylor Tuivasa, this is after the really poorly shot, I have to say, fire in the house scene where they save the kids and stuff. Really poorly shot. Taylor says to Zavala while they're in a convenience store, "Do you feel like a hero?" Zavala says back, "Huh? No." Taylor says, "What's a hero feel like?" Zavala, "I don't know." Taylor, "Me neither." There is their, I don't know, what is that supposed to be? Like, very humble acceptance of the title now, and we're supposed to love them even more for being, like, it's just the line of duty. That's what I felt like this movie was. Like, we're just doing the thing that we're supposed to. We're brothers and sisters-in-law, and once we take the contract, we're no, like, we're still human, but we're so by the code that, you know, honor is we just dust our shoulders off with honor. We don't even know what that is. We save people from burning buildings. We don't even know what a hero is. We've never felt like one because we're just cops. You know, it's
I hate that mentality because A, it doesn't exist, and B, it's okay to use validation you get for things you do in life that are positive to continue, like, using that as motivation to continue to be a good person. You could be like, yeah, I'm a hero, but, like, it's who gives a shit? You know, you could, like, acknowledge that you did something great and then move on from it. You're allowed to.
Yes.
You know?
I agree. The characterization was far too extreme and a non-direction, really.
It was like, for me, it was like valor porn.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it was like speaking to, like, ex-military and ex-police for their service and how they did it without bragging and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. But, like, they overdosed it to the point where, to me, it was puke, you know?
Just showing up to the mall during Christmas shopping in your full fatigues, even though you haven't seen action in, like, 20 years.
And usually those are, like, stolen valor guys where they're not standard issue or whatever.
Yeah.
Number five. Yeah. What'd you say?
From the surplus store, they just went to, like, the, like, the Army Navy surplus store.
Yeah, and then they have, like, a collection hat where they have, like, a fireman's helmet, but they're in, like, full army fatigue.
Go ahead.
Number five, they're hiding from gangsters in, like, a back alley after Taylor was shot, and understandably, Zavala's pretty upset because they had called for backup, and of course it doesn't show up on time, but they're hiding in a back alley from all these gangsters that they know are following them around with AK-47s trying to find them, and he's like, "Where the fuck is everybody?" at the top of his lungs. It's like setting off, it's not so much the dialogue, it's how dumb you'd have to be to start screaming at the top of your lungs when there's people all around the neighborhood searching for you. Like, a couple streets away, they're going to be there. And lo and behold, there they are after he screams, where the fuck is everybody? Like, his backup. You know what I mean? Like, fine, say it over your fucking walkie-talkie again. But say it. Don't scream it out loud. It's just
and, like, they're gonna, the first place a gang member's going to check is a fucking alley.
Yeah, right. And if they haven't yet, take that as a blessing. Don't scream at the top of your lungs. Come on, save me! Pow, pow, pow! Pow, pow! He's like, shoot off flares. He's like, starts a fire and smoke signaling.
Yeah.
Number four. This is Zavala again. You guys remember, it's towards the beginning. He's like getting kind of reprimanded for not writing up slips. Mm-hmm. Because when you're on duty, you're supposed to write up every incident that you come across. And the two of them, Taylor and Zavala, are getting in trouble for not writing up everything that happens as they go along. So Taylor throws it to Zavala and he's like, my partner has a question. And the Sarge says, OK, go ahead. And he says, I don't really know how to read or write. I do sign and I draw pictures. And then the Sarge says, seriously, you don't start writing. The captain's going to shit on my head. Then I'm going to shit on your head. Another one of these, like, everybody's a tough guy, like, I don't know, is that does that sound like I feel like that's something my dad might say to me about, like if you don't mow the lawn, your mother's gonna shit on my head and then I'm gonna shit on your head. Like, when I was like 15 or something like that. Doesn't make the Sarge seem like a tough guy to me.
Yeah, the mayor's gonna have my ass, like that whole
mentality. Not even that well written. He's gonna shit on my head.
If it was well written, it wouldn't have. It sounded like something you say and then regret a second later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why did I have to say that? God. Yeah. Like, I wanted shit and I wanted, like, the understanding, like, that I'm under pressure here, but I didn't want, like, the weight of the poop on my head to be the pressure.
Maybe,
I wanted
maybe it's an astute metaphor. Like, you know, shit trickles down from the top.
Oh, yeah. You guys right now, you guys are my toes, and eventually that shit on my head's going to drip down to my toes and cover you.
No. Don't give him that credit. it sounds like it was a Happy Gilmore when he said, I eat pieces of shit like you for breakfast. And he's like, you eat shit for breakfast?
Yeah,
that's exactly what that was.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. I'm not a huge Adam Sandler guy, but that movie's not bad.
Yeah, also, it's got zingers.
It was an apt comparison, okay? I'll give me that.
Bob, it was. It absolutely was. Let's start to our next clip. This one's called Best Man.
All right. Janet, you got a lot of heart hooking up with a cop. Because it takes a strong person.
And I see, like, a lot of cops' wives in here. They're all nodding their heads.
You got to take care of her, bro. Because I'm a big brother now.
And every cop in here... We're all her family now, too. I'm gonna cry, baby. Shut up. And Janet, we're all hoping that you can make a man out of Brian because we've all given up. So here we go. To Brian and Janet. Cheers.
Every time someone equates work to family, I check out 100%.
Yeah, I agree.
He's like, yeah.
You do not, you don't want to enter a work atmosphere where, like, oh, we're all family, because then they're going to ask you for extra favors and things like that. You're my brother, you're my sister, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Have I told you guys the story about me bombing a best man speech yet? At least I told you on air.
I never heard
No.
it.
Do you want to hear it?
Go it's ahead. Pretty...
Yeah, that's good content.
So, Bill, if you're listening, I'm really sorry. Bill Chevette, a friend of the pod, a friend of mine, asked me to be the best man in this wedding, and I was honored. But it was my first time speaking in front of that many people, and I, despite being a podcast co-host, I actually struggle when the warm bodies are there in front of me, 130, 150 people right there staring at me. Right, if we're in this medium, it's not so bad because I know we have about that many people listening. But they're not standing there or sitting there in this case, staring at me,
watching you sweat.
Trying to deliver. Yeah. So I have 7 index cards, right? That I wrote down. I felt like I came up with this like really good best man speech about, how Bill and Sarah are obviously in love, and it was all cutesy and stuff like that. And Bill and I, our history was that we played a lot of poker together, even in high school, middle school. We were gambling. We were like playing mini golf for money. We were playing Texas Hold'em at school and during study halls and stuff like that. You know, so I had all these analogies like laced within where I felt like. You know, and Bill was always a cautious player, but he went all in with Sarah, and I was all about it because blah blah blah, right? So I'm so nervous about the speech I have to give that I memorized the entire thing, and this is never a good thing. Like, you don't want to memorize it word for word, because then if you lose your place and don't remember what the last thing you said was, you have no idea where you are.
Yeah,
because you weren't listening to yourself, right? This is a lesson I learned after giving the best man speech. I will admit, Bill, I'm sorry. I did have some drinks before the best man speech started, but I promise I practiced this 7 index card speech in the car on the hour and 15 minute drive there. Had it all fucking to a T memorized. Had some drinks, got up there, stood in front of all these people, got super nervous, forgot where I was, started flipping through the index cards, trying to figure out exactly where I was. Everybody starts heckling me.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Oh, no.
I started getting heckled like I'm a stand-up comedian trying to make a living. And I try to recover. So I say, I've only got 7 index cards, but somehow I'm in index card number 9. You know, I get a little bit of a laugh from the audience, which boosts me. And then I finish the speech and anyway, I bombed it. point is, I put a lot of time and effort into that.
Yeah.
I ended up getting completely trashed because I was super embarrassed afterwards. I felt like I ruined their wedding. I definitely didn't ruin their wedding, but I felt that way.
Yeah.
You know, so I got as drunk as I've ever been in my life after that. but I put a lot of time and effort. I put a lot of love into that speech. It wasn't short. It wasn't sweet. it was bombed for sure. But if I could have done that, where I'm just like, we're all cops, we're brothers and sisters, but we'll look after you, and, you know, you're going to make him a man, because we've all been trying to, like, 15 seconds. Those two are supposed to be as close, they're supposed to be brothers, like, from other mothers, best fucking friends, right?
Yeah.
Like, killing people together, in the line of duty.
Yep.
What bond is stronger than that? And that was his best man speech. I'm sorry, it's not number 1 because it gets even worse. I just had to tell that story. I'm sorry, Bill. Again, I really am. I hope it wasn't as bad as all that. Number 2, Taylor. Number 2, Taylor says, "To Big Evil," who I mentioned before. So, Mr. Big Evil, why do they call you Big Evil? Big Evil says back, because my evil is big.
Yeah.
I mean, how lazy can you be? Is that the laziest writing you've ever heard? I think Double Dragon tried harder than that.
Yeah, no, Double Dragon tried harder than that.
Yes, they did. Every movie we've done tried harder than that.
Yeah.
I heard better speeches out of Henchmen for the Power Corps than I did out of Big Evil there.
Yep.
Finally, just to tie the bow on the dialogue and how bad it is, let's go to our shortest clip ever recorded after our drum roll. Brother.
He was my brother.
There it was. There was his funeral speech. just to cement for you the kind of chemistry those two had. There's the big speech he gave at the funeral for Michael Pena at the end. I don't know. I'll leave it to you. I feel like I've been a chatterbox, so you guys go ahead.
I have no words. Bob, you go ahead.
No, that was... I almost stopped watching before the funeral scene, kind of knowing where it was going, and then when I saw that, I'm like, I'm glad I stuck around. That was so bad. It's got to make the worst dialogue.
Yeah.
Can you imagine you're like... say what you will about Jake Gyllenhaal, he's a professional actor who's been involved in a lot of projects, even if he's not the best. Imagine when he read the script. I mean, there's no way that he didn't improv that. They had him go up. It was a major device in the movie. To have him speak at the funeral to elicit the tears from the audience. And they felt like, we don't know how to do that.
Yeah.
So we're going to have him so choked up that that's all he can utter, because we don't know how to write anything monumental here that's going to leave the audience feeling moved. So we're going to make him look as moved as possible.
Yeah.
And give him
I would say the other possibility is they were thinking kind of like a picture's worth a thousand words, kind of like this situation's bigger than words and we can't really put words to it. So we're just going to say this and let the audience feel the rest. It's complete crap. But
I agree. All right. That does alleviate some of the pain from that scene for me. But still, I feel like you have to know if you're writing that script. If you're everyone checking off the script and saying, okay, this is going to be the finalized version of the movie. No one's going to quote you. No one's going to quote Jake Gyllenhaal after this movie is over. This is not like you said about Training Day. King Kong's got nothing on me.
Yeah.
Nobody's going to be like, you were my brother.
Yeah.
Like, ever. Nope. You know, that's not going to stick with anybody. It's not going to become a part of the American lexicon, right? It's just not.
It's a missed opportunity.
Yeah, it is. It definitely is. But I guess, again, they just knew that the dialogue was not going to be the shining. It wasn't going to be the stallion for this movie.
I would never play a pickup basketball game with you guys, and as I'm dunking, yell, "My evil is big," before breaking the backboard.
No. he shatters the glass backboard.
Like, Bob gets on his knees and I run up his back and jump and I clear Chris's mastodonic height. Like, my evil is big. It's never going to happen.
Oh, I want to see that now, though.
Yeah, I'd pay to see that.
Maybe if we get really good at video editing, we can try to do something. All right, let's do test number four, the worst acting.
Test number four, the worst acting. Naturally, we'd use the Catwoman thing for this one. Yeah.
All right, let's throw it to some clips. This clip heavy always. It's four clips, starting with Captain.
I'd like to welcome Bags of All and Taylor. DA cleared these guys in last month's shooting. It turned out to be a good shooting. I know firsthand what you guys went through. It's an unpleasant experience being under that much scrutiny. But you need to remember something. An on-the-job shooting is still considered a homicide. It's never an easy ride. If you do the right thing, I will always have your back. Do the wrong thing and cross me, I will personally throw you under the bus. Am I clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Taylor, am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Sergeant, am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Have a nice day.
Thank you, Captain.
He doesn't have to qualify throwing them under the bus with personally, because who else would be doing it?
True. That's true. That's a dialogue issue for sure. But even beyond that, I felt like I've said this on the pod before, but this is going to be a theme for me going forward. He's one of those actors that seems like he can't get off screen fast enough. Like, he doesn't want to be there. Like, he is scared of his moment, I think, this captain. He's like, he's a guy that's been doing, like, local improv theater or something like that, and he finally got his big-time shot. And he was, like, scared, worse than I was for my best man speech. He just had to get out of there. You know, he was just so fucking scared. And he delivered it half-heartedly, and everybody's like, well, that was a big fart, but let's just go with it.
If he was like, if he had the attitude of like the drill sergeant from like Full Metal Jacket and yelled that exact line with a slightly different cadence, it would have been like, it's still a homicide. If you fuck up, I will personally throw you under the bike. Someone just, you know, it didn't have it behind it.
Well said, Rob. He had no. Go ahead, Bob.
No, I was just saying good point.
It is. Yeah, it is. I think that would have definitely saved the whole character, because I think that's really, I think he has one other line in the movie somewhere mixed in, but who gives a shit? This guy, maybe after that, they were like, you know what, let's forget it. Maybe that guy shows up on an episode of NCIS at some point or something. Yeah. But that was his shot at the big time, and he got scared and just gave up. That's what it felt like to me.
I think Rob has a future in directing cop movies.
Yeah.
It's the person who doesn't want to lead who's sometimes the best for the position. And Rob hates cop movies, so maybe he's the best person to direct.
Stacy watches, and I watch by consequence, every single NCIS, CSI, Criminal Minds, Chicago PD. Like, I watch all those just by happenstance. And I know the beats, man. I know the fucking beats.
Exactly. I guarantee that you've seen that guy before then.
Yeah.
He was like the guy who was like, no, please don't shoot. And then got shot in the chest. Let's throw it to our next clip. This one's called Homeboy.
What's up, putos? Big bad Wiki from Curbside Gang Locals. Ready for this shit?
Fuck yeah, I was born to fucking do this shit. Yeah,
that's right.
Show these motherfuckers who barrio this is.
Turn the light, stupid. You're gonna get us pulled over, lie.
Fuck that shit. I had to fucking be at work. You better not bust out wasting my motherfucking time, homie. I'm gonna tell you that shit right now.
Hey, Lala, are you gonna fuck the homeboy?
Not fucking the homeboy, dog. Yeah, shit. Right? What I look like? The little fucking paisa hoochies you guys fucking kick it with? I'm laying the bitch. Maybe.
I'm packing a motherfucking 30-round clip for you slob ass niggas.
This is it right here, man.
Slow down. This is the street, dog.
This is it. This is street. It. All right, then, Wicked, you're gonna jump and get the party started. Got it?
Got it. I got you, baby. I got this
one to the homie.
All right, put your fucking face on. Let's go.
Get your shit ready.
Fucking truth, man. Get that fucking shit away, man. Make sure your fucking shit is good to go. What the fuck do I gotta fucking tell you, man? I don't wanna fucking have to baby you, man.
Get ready, honey. Just get ready.
Put your fucking face on.
All right, man.
Whoa. You guys ready?
I'm ready.
All right.
I don't know if you guys remember the very, very small bit minor role in the movie Waiting with Andy Milonakis. And
yes.
Yes.
And they're like on the rooftop and they're like, yeah, we're going to get this fucking chronic and we're going to roll with it. And
yeah. He's like the kid that takes out the garbage, right? Like,
Yeah, the little fat kid.
Yeah. I felt like she was the exact opposite of the captain. Like, she was a girl that, like, worked at the Panera, who was, like, an upstanding citizen, who was doing the Upstanding Citizens Brigade. Is that the improv group out of, like, Detroit or whatever, the big one? The
Upright Citizens Brigade, yeah, the UCB.
And she got a shot at the big time and then went for it, like, way over the top.
Yeah.
Because she does not know how to do the, like, gangster accent or you know, whatever she's really going for there, the, like, L.A., you know, Curb Street Gang thing she was doing, because Lala, I think, is her character's name, is among the worst actresses we've seen so far. It is so cringy that I almost didn't want to clip it just because I didn't want to hear her again, because she is, like, just, for me, the kind of, like, I can't help but to start curling. Like, towards my center, like in a ball.
It's, you know, that second-hand embarrassment you get for somebody. You know when you get, like, embarrassed on someone's behalf?
Yes.
Like, they're not embarrassed, but you're like, oh, like that. That's the feeling. Like, you just want to, like, bite your knuckles off.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
That's what I got from that.
Same here. Just really, really poor line delivery, in my opinion. Not to mention that we were talking about Big Evil's F-bomb script as well.
Yeah.
Maybe he was throwing in some extras just for the fun of it, but who knows? We're going to throw it now to our next clip called Feds.
Sir, and I don't want to cause any trouble here, but we rolled up here. I don't know what's going on. It's the second cowboy like this we run into in a week.
Watch out for these guys. They operate by a different set of rules.
I know I'm just a ghetto street cop, but you got to give me something here.
We've got indicators he's a runner for the Sinaloa cartel.
Yeah, well, we ran it. It came up clean, dude.
You guys don't have the proper clearance for any of this information, but I'm going to throw you a bone. Cartels are operating here. We're on it. Be careful.
What does that mean, though?
It means you and your homeboy need to power down. You've just tugged on the tail of the snake. It's gonna turn around and bite you back. I'm throwing you a bone here.
I'm grateful for
what I'm giving you.
I'm giving you a warning.
Lay low.
Can I get your name for my log?
Negative. Move along.
Yeah, all right. Sir, you know that there's 5-year-old kids in there?
All right, dude.
For 6 months?
Goodbye. Get off the crime scene and go home.
Bye.
Have a nice night.
Yep. Z, what the fuck, man? Fuck them.
Ugh.
That guy that's supposed to be a fed is really bad. So he, like, I felt like all of his dialogue there was bad. He's got like a little monologue where it's like 4 sentences worth, but one of them is where he's like, "You just tugged on the tail of a snake." And it reminds me of that Sneaky Snake kid that went.
I'm a sneaky snake. That's one of the first viral videos I've ever seen. It's just that guy dressed like a snake. I'm a sneaky snake.
I'm a sneaky little snake. Yeah. Reminded me of that, definitely. But I thought that guy was particularly bad. And I wanted to bring something up to you guys to see if you agree. But sometimes with these found footage movies like Blair Witch, Cloverfield, stuff like that. Cloverfield is an exception, maybe, because it is a major, major production where they put a lot of money into it. But these movies that are shot on like literal camcorders or like just a rank above.
Yeah.
There's something about the raw quality where it doesn't. I feel like a higher quality camera actually masks. There's almost like a shield that it puts over an actor. Like if you have a really low quality camera and it gives you that home video kind of feel, the charade of Hollywood is gone.
Yeah.
Like you start to feel like, oh, well, this is a home video, so I'm going to start to treat this person like they're not an actor. Like this is realism. So when you get a guy like this who feels very raw, he might have gotten away with it if it felt like a major production, I guess is going.
That makes sense.
Got these like back yard camcorder cameras that you're recording this guy on, you don't give him any credit. And immediately you just want to like douse this guy in gasoline and light him on fire because he's just that bad, you know.
It's partially the quality of the camera, but also the quality of the camera angle. When you're dealing with a found footage or a body cam type thing, you don't get to choose the angle, and then the actor doesn't get to emote quite the same way.
Yeah, they don't know where to turn or not turn. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the thing with the found footage, just because you brought it up, I'm going to mention it now because you mentioned the Blair Witch. Found footage stuff works really well with unknown actors. Because you believe it more. It's Jake Gyllenhaal. You know it's Jake Gyllenhaal. I can't remove myself from it enough to say that's not him.
No, and obviously, because he's constantly like, because he has to show his badge, which means that he has to lift his cheeks. Because they're like drooping over his badge on his chest, and he's like pick the cheeks back up and put them back on his face. And
the cool thing about Blair Witch Project was it was 1997, so like early internet, IMDb was around, but like they told every resident in the town those kids were filming in about the legend of the Blair Witch, and they didn't tell the actors that they told the whole town. So the whole town was in on this joke, making the kids actually more scared. And on the IMDb page, the actors were credited with last known whereabouts. They didn't they made a lore that was convincing.
Further than that, they told their family and friends for like 3 months that they were
gone.
Missing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
like the actors, that's what I heard anyway, but they had signed on to agree to that. So they just stayed in some hotel.
Yeah. The kids in the movie
was released.
Yeah. And the kids in the movie weren't genuine. Like they weren't like trained actors at that point. And they were genuinely afraid on camera. And like there was more to it. When you do it with a cop movie, it's just hard to, especially with big name actors, it's hard to suspend disbelief. Cause just like, no, you're Jake.
You're
droopy,
I agree.
You're droopy Jake.
Exactly.
Droopy Jake and saggy Gyllenhaal.
Anywho, moving on.
Anyway, we got one more clip.
Yeah.
This before one's called, we throw your ad read, sorry, Saggy Gyllenhaal. I've been trying to throw that in there.
This one's just called Cops.
Yeah.
Wait till they hit a small street.
at a stop sign, you fucking tap the bumper. We're gonna get out and blast.
Fuck no.
What do you mean no?
We should get them when they go to lunch at the Chinese place.
That Chinese place is crawling with cops. We gotta get these fuckers when they're alone.
We can fucking follow their asses home and hit them there.
We know, go. White boys in fucking Simi Valley, the other fucking fools in St. Gabriel. We gotta get these fuckers at the same time.
Hey, this is one time, homie. Not a bunch of fucking niggas.
Motherfucker! This fucking shit straight from the fucking shoot, homeboy. You stop fucking around. You get in the fucking car. You wanna fucking hang with the fucking Canales? Now you fucking pay the fucking price of fucking admission, homeboy. I'll fucking kill this fucking bitch. All right? You shut the fuck up.
Come on,
shit, I'm gonna fucking
come
bitch.
On, homie.
I'll fucking kill you, motherfucker. Don't you what fucking disrespect.
Got this shit. Fuck, man.
I don't know where the fucking rubber band is either.
Don't blame me for the rubber band, dude. You just took the rubber band
If you
off.
Hadn't fucking put everything out of order, dude, then the rubber band wouldn't be out in the... Look, dude, it's butterfly effect, okay? Do you know what the butterfly effect is?
Nope.
It's a butterfly effect. Look it up.
Just because you say it twice doesn't mean that I get it the second time.
that last line is pretty fucking funny, though.
Yeah.
Just because you said it twice doesn't mean I got it.
Yeah, true. I actually wish I didn't include that because that is funny and I don't want to give this movie any credit. Yeah. But the amount, so if you guys want to just open this up now, I'm going to talk about it in the catch-all, so I'll just skip it. Mm-hmm. Most offensive, probably.
All right.
How many times do you have to say fucks for it to feel like a hardcore movie?
Yeah.
The guy Big Evil there, he turned... I don't feel like any criminal organization would ever be able to function with the amount of aggression that Big Evil puts on display there. Because, like, he not only is he fucking everything, but he turns around and he puts a pistol into the face of his second in command's girlfriend and says, "I'm going to kill this bitch right now."
You still got to like make payroll and
like
do your rounds and make sure people are okay on your team. You know what I mean? It's basic HR shit. You got to do that shit even in a gang.
Like if you are like literally such a psychopath that you're about to kill anybody on your staff.
Yeah.
Nobody would work for you. You have to have leadership qualities, even if you're leading a gang. It's not realistic that guy is so unhinged that he's about to shoot somebody in the car with him before they do it.
Yeah.
Like a drive-by, you know, it's just not realistic at all.
Yeah.
Not to mention how over the top he was. I mean, this is an acting category, so Big Evil was just awful there. But the script doesn't help him at all. If that wasn't the script, then they didn't just say throw fucks in whenever you want because we want the wrong quality of fuck to be all over this movie. I don't know. Ridiculous.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I thought Bob was going to say something.
Nope.
Oh,
okay. Let's start to your ad read, Rob.
Yeah, here we go.
This summer, the streaming event of the decade, brought to you by the worst movie ever made. Watch co-host Rob, watch Cat in the Hat, in its entirety, at half speed. He will drink a gallon of water, and he's not allowed to go to the bathroom.
No! No!
Why, I'm the Cat in the Hat! There's no doubt about that. I'm a super bum who's here to make sure that you are. I'm a cat that can talk. There should be enough for you.
Coming soon.
Honestly, if you didn't keep reminding us, I think we'd both have forgotten about this by now.
I know, but foreshadowing. I do have a game for you two starting next season.
Sick.
So just
oh, nice.
Get ready.
Games are great, dude. The more game type things we throw in, the more the listener enjoys.
It's a it should be a very quick segment on the show as far as like footprint on the timeline, but the consequence will be large. So
awesome.
Let's cool.
looking forward to it, I think.
Yeah,
definitely.
let's throw it now to the worst production.
The worst movie ever made presents worst production.
Again, I'm keeping this short and sweet tonight because of the my overall opinion of this movie. So here it is. If the audience cares about characters, mm-hmm. the story's more gripping, sometimes more real. We were never made to care about any of the characters in this movie, which made us not care about this movie or its dumb characters.
Mm-hmm. I completely agree.
Yeah.
That's where it ends for me, is just I didn't care about anybody. It's like a bad horror movie when like no one matters. So
yeah,
there's nothing to be scared about because you're like, yeah, good, die, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's kind of where I ended up with this one.
So Bob, to your point, I just thought of this when you said that. I love Texas Chainsaw franchise. I thought the reboots were good. Texas Chainsaw Begins, I was in theaters with like four people and they were all surprised there were no survivors. And I'm sitting there completely detached going like, well, I knew they were all going to die. It's fucking Texas Chainsaw Begins. Like, you're not supposed to get attached to any of these people because he's not going to get caught for like 10 fucking years. And that's right. The same kind of baseline feeling I have while watching this. Just there's nothing there.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. And I'm going to cap my comments on that until we open it up a little bit more, a little bit, but completely agree. Let's throw it then to test number five, the most offensive, before we head over to the catch-all.
Damn it! I am tired of being Santa Claus! You get your together, and you get your ass in a damn car! We're going! Now, damn it! Okay.
Starting with Z to T, that's Zoologist Taylor. Admit it, you'd hit that shit, talking about one of the female cops.
Yep.
Taylor says back to Zavala, yeah, with a cinder block.
yeah.
I mean, they had to. Not cool. You have two attractive females on the force. You have to mention how the lead character would like to have sex with them. And then the other lead character is like, oh, no, I'd never have sex with them. I'm way too good for that, so I'd rather hit her with a cinder block because she deserves that.
And then I think I'd like to have a daughter.
Zavala and some gangster get in a fight,
mm-hmm.
like an actual fist fight, which would never, ever, ever fucking happen.
No.
Because of the criminal investigation that would go on by the department for the fist fight that happened. Yeah. But not only that, but the gangster guy like beats Zavala basically, and then stops punching him.
Mm-hmm.
He just is like, "Okay, you've had enough." And then Zavala comes back and starts fighting him again. That gangster dude would just continue punching him until he's unconscious or whatever, like four doors.
Because if you're in for a penny, then you should be in for a if he's in his mind, I'm already going to jail for assaulting a cop. I might as well beat the ever living fuck out of him.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, and then he would turn and start trying to fight Brian Taylor after that as well.
Yeah.
The everyone has a quinceañera joke I did not find to be particularly tasteful. I know they do a lot of back and forth about white people and Hispanic people.
Yeah.
But that one in particular struck a chord with me. I don't know what that was. There was also a Home Depot joke that I didn't particularly like, but the like quinceañera thing was a little rough for me.
Right.
How about going through a cop's belongings at his home, including playing with his gun after a first date?
Yeah. Probably not wise.
She just pulls out his fucking pistol and is like, oh, you know, can you not like touch his pistol? You know, that's really not supposed to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Taylor says after they apprehend the very large Hispanic man and the curbside gang or whatever, who stabbed Van Housen or whatever in the face and then beat almost to death the rookie female cop, she is laying there bloodied with her face caved in and she's conscious. And Taylor says over her body, "Fuck, man, her face is all broken in." Mm. She's sitting there listening, and you say her face is broken in. You want to be like, you're going to be fine. You're good. You're going to recover. You want to give them the, like, Bubba, Bubba Blue right. treatment where, like, you're going to get home. We'll be fine. You know, like, you don't want to be like, oh, no, all your bones in your face are broken. You're probably going to be ugly for the rest of your life. If you survive. Who knows? And then, like I said, for me, the F-bomb script, we kind of talked about it. It's just too much. I don't care. I fuck fucks. And I fuck on this podcast, Rob, you and I fuck on this podcast all the time. in front of the listening audience. But,
I didn't want to weigh in though. Wouldn't it be really funny if, like, I know they're probably improvising a lot of that and just throwing it in. But wouldn't it be funny if, like, that every single fuck was written in the script and they were memorizing it?
Yeah.
You only said fuck 97 times. This is 98. 98. And they have to do it all over again.
So after I say fucking going, you want me to throw a fucking there. Fucking. Yeah. Right? So fucking going, fucking there, fucking is the line I... It's just totally ridiculous, and it made me feel like they think I'm really stupid. I don't know. Like, I'm really immature or something, and I need all those fuckings to feel like it's hard.
It's locker room. Like, the whole movie's like locker room talk.
Yeah.
That's how I would describe it. That's how I was telling Stacey about it, because she's like, I'm not going to watch this one. But I was like, it's locker room talk. It's what they think bros do, like, after hitting the gym in like the
Think bros do, but every bro is fucking annoyed by the fucking guy who's fucking saying fucking after every fucking word he fucking says.
Yeah.
Because, like, how simple and immature are you that you need to, it's good. It's a good word for emphasis. You know, curse words are great. I love them. I use them to, put, you know, a little extra oomph on what I'm trying to deliver.
Some of my best friends are curse words. Sorry, I was just...
I don't see four-letter words. Yeah. I don't see them. I don't
even know. Right.
All right, let's throw it to the catch-all, because we got no shitcoin this week again. All right.
Sounds good. Gotta catch them all.
Hopper from Stranger Things. I said it already, but if you didn't catch that, he's Van Housen or whatever. Can cops just have camcorders?
I mean, I think by law they have to have, like, a body cam now, but I think...
Well,
like,
and they have those, too.
I think it's got to be a weird wiretap law. It's got to be a weird wiretap law, because, like, technically, you are a cop in uniform, but you're holding your camcorder as, like, a civilian.
Yeah.
I'm not a lawyer, but...
I mean, to be fair, they did make mention of that more than once, about how you can't be recording just everything. You know, that's being subpoenaed.
True. Yeah, they can subpoena that. Yeah, they do say that.
You're right, though. No, they can't do that.
So many impossible camera shots on the subject. My favorite was when Anna Kendrick, is that her name?
One of the wives.
Janet character. I know she becomes much more popular after this movie. But she and Jake Gyllenhaal are, on their third date, and doing things that you might do to close out a third date on a bed somewhere in someone's apartment. And the found footage stops, but then we have, like, a camera on the nightstand, basically, where Jake Gyllenhaal didn't put it. And it makes you wonder, like, who's recording right now? There's like, plenty of these.
Was that editorial? And that this is camcorder, but that was, like, just editorial, so you know what happened, or...
I guess the problem is, though, that they're constantly trying to push the found footage feel on you, even so much as to have gangsters, as I mentioned in the plot pitch, with camcorders.
That's my hang up is the fact that it's supposed to be found footage, and the gangsters, especially the ones who were making the hit, had footage of the whole thing, which makes zero sense.
No sense
at all. Completely no sense. There were three guys that, like, were holding AK-47s as they're ambushing Zavala and Taylor. They're running through this apartment complex. They're in the wide open. Stormtrooper. They actually shoot Taylor's hand. They shoot through the walkie-talkie thing that he's got. and into his hand. That's all they managed to hit. Whatever. Who's recording the three guys with the AK-47s, and why don't you have one too? Just to make sure that, like, there's no reason why the gangsters have cameras, and they're like, oh, we're gonna make a documentary about our Crib Street gang, or oh, we're gonna make a documentary about our, like, there's other gangster gangs that are going. It makes no sense. There's a line where after the hit, they're doing a drive by the Crib Street to the the other gang, the rival gang in the territory, and they shoot up CK, I think is the character's name, who gets shot, and he's about to die, and somebody's like, get the fucking camera out of my face. And it's like, wait a minute, so they have camcorders too? Like, which, what am I watching? Like, which ones am I watching where they're actually, like, is some gang member I don't know that's recording? Like, I have no idea what's found footage and what's supposed to be, as you said, you know, like, established shots for just because it's storytelling. I really have no idea.
It almost gives off, like, a Last Action Hero vibe, where, like, they know they're on the set of a movie.
Yeah, right, exactly. That's not what you want, though. They haven't been dating for 2 months, according to the cop cams, because I checked the fucking dashboard cams.
Okay.
I said to myself, go back and look at the dashboard cam, because it gives you the date of everything that happens every time they show the dashboard cam. Right. So then you can track. Then you can track how long Janet and Jake fall off face pulled pork Gyllenhaal are dating. Right. And I look back, and it's 5/25/11 to 7/5/11, and in that time they started dating and got married. It's been not even 2 months, and they're married. I thought he was supposed to be really smart.
I don't want to go against what you just said, but I've met some people that are in that kind of line of work, or maybe military. Who do get attached that quickly, and then they go away for like 18 months, and then they think the newborn that happened when they get home was from them.
You don't want to get married that quickly is my connection. I don't think you don't know the person that well yet. Live together for a little while and see if you can stand the other person.
If you can get past the roommate phase, I think you're good, but like
They keep pulling more and more illegal stuff out of the pickup truck. The one that they got the license plate off of, even though he was sideways and they couldn't see his license plate. And so they pull him over and they're like, oh my God, here's some money. Oh my God, here's some drugs. Oh my God, it's Liberace's AK-47. I pictured them like pulling. Now they're like, oh my God, it's a car. They like pull that out of the truck. Like, oh my God, it's a pickup truck.
Like in Austin Powers, like the silhouette tent scene when they just keep shoving things up his ass.
Yeah, exactly.
Like they're like hammering a missile with like a sledgehammer.
Exactly like that. Wanted to mention that Taylor and Janet go on a date. And it's literally them driving on the highway, and they just show the highway sign that says Las Vegas. But they don't go there because it's not in the budget. So literally the whole date was just them driving on the highway.
Oh, they didn't even stop over at Reno or anything?
No, nothing. Nope. I mentioned that already. So they wrapped around the eye of the knife, like the stab in Van Housen's or whatever his name is. Knife, they wrap that up so nicely that it really looked like a prop eye and not a knife in his eye, believe it or not. Yeah. That actually didn't look anything like he had been stabbed in the eye. The bad guys are terrible at hiding their crimes. Two dudes just show up and they hear like screaming babies, so they kick down the door and there they are in cages. Or they like show up because there's like some kind of dispute over a welfare check, and there's 30 bodies in this house.
Yeah,
maybe get your shit in order before you decide to chop up bodies and shit like that.
It's like we talked about like Gacy got busted for weed, and then they found like 35 kids under the floorboards.
The wall in that house where there's all these chopped up bodies, right? Says blah, 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 blah in Spanish. And they do a very bad job of telling you what it actually says. So yeah. I'll do that for you. There was a spot under like a lamp that I couldn't read. So I couldn't put it into Google Translate, but it says greetings something. Keep sending people. Ha ha ha. That's what it said on the wall where all the people were murdered.
Yeah, I think I looked that up as well to find the same result, thinking, what the hell does that even mean?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I don't, for what? To kill? Like, yeah. What, exactly. Yeah, are you making money just chopping people into bits? some dude with a cowboy hat and a horse and night vision?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't understand that scene at all. It's like the lord from down south, the M13, like, gang lord was calling a shot down to the Curb Street gang or whatever, but it's intercepted by some guy who's wearing a cowboy hat and is like walking a mule around like a spice grinder old school or something like that. Yeah. It was like, why is this guy, like, we don't know who this dude is, and why is it night vision? Like, literally no shot has been established in night vision yet. So
yeah,
really weird for me. I thought the shaving cream gag and Janet's pregnancy were just shitty setup for the climax. I mean, it was like shoved in minutes before they got into their really hairy situation. Mm-hmm. So it was supposed to, like, in case you didn't love these guys yet, she's pregnant and they're jokesters. Don't know if you know that about these characters who are about to get out. Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah. No reloads. Nobody reloads ever.
Yeah. Yeah.
Take the guy's car. There's a guy who's like in an alleyway and he like puts a shotgun on them and they shoot him. He's dead. He's got a running car. Take it. Get in that fucking Pinto and drive your asses out of there.
Yeah.
Why are you still running down the alleyway?
Yeah.
When I was taking some notes, okay, I'm not going to lie. I finished this movie this morning. I've been working a lot.
Yeah.
On that subject, I've been working so much that I've been like kind of exhausted. I haven't been sleeping a lot. I've just been really out of sorts lately. And when that happens to me, when I'm on the verge of exhaustion, like total physical exhaustion, mental exhaustion, I choke up easy. I see a story on 2020. My wife tells me about some news thing that she read where a kid got out and ends up kidnapped or something. I choke up. It could have been Frasier. And Daphne and Niles hook up.
Well, friends and
I'm
moving.
Like, oh my God, I'm like, I'm tearing up, you know, like I can't help myself. When I'm really tired, I get choked up. This movie had literally no effect on me. Funeral scene, nothing.
Nothing.
I was on like 4 hours of sleep. I just worked 60 hours in a row. Yeah. I super exhausted. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. Just want to say that's, that's not the end of my catch-all. There's one more. The day of the shooting, .. This is like the Easter egg after the funeral.
Yeah.
That scene was so lame. I really wanted to turn it off, but I felt like there's 3 minutes left or whatever. Yeah. I'll just suffer through it. It's Gabby's parents' sex joke scene between Michael Pena and Jake Gyllenhaal.
Yeah.
Horrible. Oh, dude, you know, we're like best buddies. You're telling me a story you should tell me. I don't know. I hated this movie. Let's throw it to Bob Hasek's Fact or No Fact.
All right, let me get that going for you.
The worst movie ever made presents Fact or No Fact.
Okay, so I couldn't tell if I went easy on this week because I knew Rob already lost. Because it was a police movie. But here we go.
Okay.
Five bits of information, one of which is true, four of which are lies.
Nice.
Okay, first one. Both main characters, that'd be Gyllenhaal and Pena, were supposed to die, but the director thought it was too much for the audience to handle. Okay, second. Okay. With real police on staff as consultants, the donut budget exceeded the special effects budget. Okay, third one. Originally, there was supposed to be a white supremacist gang, but it was cut because the audiences know that white supremacy doesn't exist. Okay, fourth one. The audience started trusting the LAPD after this movie came out because, you know, obviously. And lastly, Audiences know this movie is fiction because the police don't actually curse or shoot guns in real life. Okay. So either both characters are supposed to die, donut budget high, white supremacist doesn't exist, trusted the LAPD, or cops don't curse or shoot.
Oh, man, about halfway through, it got surprisingly topical, political, and it made me laugh pretty hard. So I'm still recovering from that. Rob, do you want to go first, or do you want me to try to suffer through it?
I think I know the answer. I'm going to say what I rule out. I think the police don't curse one. I think that's out because that's just
yeah.
I don't think anybody's ever trusted the LAPD, and I don't think they ever will. Yeah. The white supremacy one I'm going to rule out because that one, see, I almost believe that one because like it's one of those things in 2012, like we knew was a problem, but we didn't want to acknowledge that it was.
Didn't want to, but we used to at least.
Yeah. But like now it's like, pretty out in the open since during elections and stuff. Real police on the staff, donut budget. I mean, that's a lot of fucking donuts, but that's also believable. And then, so my answer is number one. I think they were both supposed to die, and I think the audience probably couldn't handle if that happened because most people that go see buddy cop movies, they can't. They're buddies, you know. You got to have the buddy. Yeah, at least one buddy survive. So
I tend to try to disagree with you, but I have to agree. I think it.
Yeah. we're both wrong.
watch. Like there is no such thing as critical race theory. Let's stop. anyway, go ahead.
I made it as obvious as I could. Yes, of course, both characters were supposed to die, but the audience couldn't handle it. Everything else was just me having fun with the last
episode. It was really fun. Yeah, that made me laugh quite a little bit.
Because we all know that white supremacy doesn't exist. So why worry about it?
Yeah.
Just like the Holocaust never. Yeah,
slavery was never a thing.
Yeah.
Never happened.
Rob is canceled.
Yeah.
Forget it.
This is slice of life stuff here, guys.
okay, so let's move it on to the alternate ending before we do back credit names, and then we will we're not gonna compare this one to anything. But we're going to see what's happening for next week.
Right. Rob, you can do this, or you can do that, or you can do this, or you can do that, or you can do this, or you can do that. Just pick one.
So basically, because like I didn't know what this movie was when you brought it on, Chris, for the poll, and you said buddy cop. So I was hoping for like Rush Hour 3, they're like slapping each other's hands at the radio and all that stuff. So I thought
we could do that one if you want.
They're driving through the seedy part of LA. They're driving through Skid Row, and they're you know, someone's doing country, someone's doing rock and roll, and they just drive straight through the gang house and kill all of them, and then. You know, then it cuts to like the commissioner's office, and he's just like, "You wrecked 20 cars," and that's it. The end.
Nice. So they're just they're so distracted by the choice of music, entertainment in the cop car that they just drive right through the.
They kill the entire cartel, and then they're just being reamed out by the commissioner about how the mayor is going to have his ass in the vice grip or whatever.
Yeah. You shit on my head, so now I'm going to shit on your head. I don't mind throwing you under a bus full of shit. It'll trickle on to you.
They don't call me old Colonel Shit Bus.
That's right.
They don't.
That's what I said.
All right, let's throw it to the bad credit names.
All right. I got to do a bumper for that next season.
Yeah, why not? It's a constant.
Yeah.
So obviously these ones get better as we go along. Right. Guy East.
Okay.
He has a twin, but he moved out to California. Julian Longnecker.
Okay.
Sounds like a kind of clam to me. It's got to be rough to be Philip Hoffman.
Oh,
he's a frequent flyer. We had a Philip Hoffman not too long ago, and you said
I don't doubt. I drink when I podcast sometimes, so it's only possible by the end of the podcast.
Is he a light guy? Is he like an actor, or is he like
he's not an actor. He's like he holds like the grips or something. You know?
All right, cool, got it.
Issy Pennell.
Okay.
Issy, I-S-S-P-E-N-N-E-L. I try not to make that too penile.
Yeah.
Right.
My wife is trying to communicate something to you. Bear with me. Do I have a charger? I do have a charger. Probably don't need it. There you go, beautiful. It's our anniversary, by the way. So it's
hey, happy anniversary.
Yeah. Oh, happy anniversary.
It's okay, babe. So it's fitting that she would make her first guest appearance.
I'm leaving that on the show.
Good. Okay. Right. America Ferreira.
Okay.
Dodie Dorn.
Okay.
Hmm.
James Pistol McNeil.
Okay.
Lee Kuwid.
Okay.
Devil Wilkins.
Okay.
It's. I think it's supposed to be Liquid. I think that's how you're supposed to say his first name.
All right.
It's L-E-E-Q-U-W-I-D. Liquid.
Yeah.
Devil Wilkins. A. Alan Dumas.
Okay.
So what you're supposed to do is say, A. Alan Dumas.
Yeah.
Hey, Alan.
Right.
Dumas. Okay. Spook James.
Okay.
Oh, wrong.
That's not good. That's very bad. And then finally, David Stank.
Ah, yes. Oh,
good old Davey Stank.
Stank is bad. Let's go for a live looking on what we're doing next week, guys. I have a strong feeling about this one. I think I know.
Do you think when David Stank dies, they change his name to Stunk?
Yeah, indeed he did. Okay, so I'm looking at our TikTok because I'm going there first now because I don't know if you guys know this, listeners. We had a post go somewhat viral, guys, with well over 10,000 views. So our poll actually has 52 votes. Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
So let's do some mental math. 52 for The Last Airbender. And 9 for Transformers on TikTok.
Okay.
So total of 61 votes already there. And we did get a late poll this week. That's my bad.
That's a lot for Airbender.
Isn't it? And then another 27 for Airbender on Instagram for 14 for Transformers. So that's 23 to, what did I say, for Transformers?
14.
20 so 76 to 23.
Yeah.
Sure.
For Last Airbender.
All right.
That's a fuck ton. And hey Bob, are you still with us? Yes! God damn it.
Every time, why does that happen?
I don't know.
What have you done, Chris?
I don't understand why I would influence his internet at all, but apparently.
Yeah, because like I'm hosting it. I'm hosting the chat.
Yeah, doesn't make any sense.
I'm doing all the audio. All you're doing is taking your picture off so you could read your script, and we lose Bob.
God so, damn it. How does that work?
Listen up, listeners. Hey. TheWorstMovieEverMade.com. We have an email address. Can you please help us troubleshoot this shit? Because, It makes sense. Chris has all his stuff on his phone. He just wants to read off his phone, guys.
I don't want to have to literally write every single thing I say down on this outline that's already 5 pages long.
Yeah.
It takes me hours to make this outline.
Huh. That is strange.
Poor Bob. I feel really bad.
What is The Last Airbender? What is it? Is it like
Avatar? It's like the story of Avatar, the cartoon.
Is it like a prequel? Is it like its own?
No, it's like its own. I feel like it's pretty. It's supposed to be the story of Avatar,
okay.
But you know, like interpreted as a movie, and I think they wanted to franchise it out. So it's actually really good for the pod because it's like Battleship or Battlefield Earth rather, where they wanted to make multiple, but it just flopped so bad, you know, that they weren't able to do so.
They had lofty expectations, and then they failed.
Exactly.
Okay. And then I'll put dead air here, and then when Bob comes back, we'll make our salutations.
Sounds good. Because
I think your picture froze too, Chris. There's Bob, but now Chris is frozen. Okay.
Can you hear me?
I hear you.
Okay, well, that's all that matters.
Okay.
Oh, that all that matters. Okay.
Bob, we put a call out to the audience. We're trying to get someone to email us with this, because I'm hosting the show. I'm hosting the audio. I'm recording it. I'm getting all the stems from you guys on Discord with the Craig bot. But when Chris reads his show script, you get bumped off, which makes zero sense.
Yeah, it's weird. If it's not on my outline, like if I have to go outside my outline to something I have on my phone, which I've been trying to do because that cuts down on my total allotted time spent on the pod every week, you get kicked off.
It's fucking weird. There's no logical reason.
I'm on a cable Wi-Fi, so it should not interfere with a phone signal.
Yeah.
Anyway, whatever.
Who knows? But for next week, I'll try.
Are we still recording?
We're still recording. Yeah, I'm going to cut out the dead air.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to try to just write down the couple of bad reviews for next week on The Last Airbender.
Okay, Last Airbender, and then you can find us at theworstmovieevermade.com, and let me roll that theme song.